नमस्ते सत श्री अकाल एंड आदाब। वेलकम टू दिस वेबिनार ऑन ट्रिपल एडवांटेज। आई एम श्योर मोस्ट ऑफ यू मस्ट हैव अंडरस्टूड द कॉन्सेप्ट। वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट थ्री असेट क्लासेस विच विल फॉर्म पार्ट ऑफ दिस ट्रिपल एडवांटेज इन योर पोर्टफोलियोज। बट इट इज़ नॉट सफिशियंट जस्ट टू हैव थ्री असेट क्लासेस। दिस थ्री असेट क्लासेस शुड बी कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री टू ईच अदर and also enhance the returns of the overall portfolio against one single asset class kind of an exposure, and at the same time reduce volatility. So we are going to talk about all these aspects and many more data and many more myths which will be broken in this particular webinar. Let's begin with triple advantage. Why this triple advantage? What are the three asset classes which we are going to talk about? What is the third asset class? And the second asset class also, of course, because I don't think we've introduced these three asset classes so far. And then finally, how do you position this particular product in your portfolio post this multi-cap recategorization by the regulator? So let's begin. Do you think you have exposure to large cap stocks? Think again. Because if you actually see the Indian context in the global context, you put the Indian equity markets in the global context, you will realize that these large cap stocks are actually small caps as far as the global markets are concerned. And that's what I will showcase you with through a few slides post this particular one. Large cap in the Indian context can be small caps in the global context. As you can see, India only has 3% of the market cap of the global market GDP, market cap exposure. 42% is the major chunk is with the US, 9% is with China, 7% with UK, almost 8% with Eurozone, something similar with Japan and so on and so forth. So we are a very minuscule part of the global market cap scenario, and on top of that, only two companies from the Indian context form part of the global 100 mega cap stocks. And I'm sure you must have guessed which these two countries are. Of course, the first one being everybody's favorite right now, Reliance and TCS. Reliance is ranked 34th and TCS is ranked 89th in the top 100 global companies list. So we only have very minuscule participation as far as the global 100 top large cap companies or mega cap companies are concerned, and only two of our Indian companies qualify in that segment. And market cap of three global companies equals total market cap of India. So if you consider market cap of say Apple, Amazon and Microsoft, recently I came across a WhatsApp forward saying that Apple's market cap is equivalent to market cap of India. I was not sure of the data, so I did not put that up. But these three market cap, the largest or the mega market cap companies of USA is equal to the market cap of the entire Indian equity space. So if you see this, Amazon, Apple and Microsoft has almost $5 trillion worth of market cap. As against that, our three top companies, which includes Reliance, TCS and HDFC Bank, the total market cap of these three companies put together is only $400 billion. There is a huge, huge difference as far as the market caps and the size of these companies are concerned, the Indian companies are concerned in the global context. But the unfortunate part is we say that we have exposure to large cap companies because we are only stuck to one asset class, which is the Indian equities in the current context. And that's the myth which I want to break by showcasing to you that why you should have exposure to the global companies also. Investors wish to stay in their comfort zone. That's the unfortunate part. There is something called familiarity bias or home bias, based on which, because we do not understand the global context in terms of investing, that's the reason we stick to investing only in the Indian companies. That is what we call home bias or the familiarity bias, and that's the reason why almost 100% of investors' money in the Indian context, 99.8% of the Indian money is invested only in Indian equities. You compare that with the four largest economies and the investors there, they have exposure to 65% of their own investments in their own home countries, but 35% exposure is to the outside countries, outside their own home countries also. Now these of course include you know, US, China, Australia and one more country. So that's the you know, reality as far as Indian investors are concerned, where they have very negligible, I mean, literally no exposure to the global companies, and those are the true mega cap or the large cap companies. What we think in large caps in terms of our Indian context really seems like, after all these slides which I have showcased to you, as small caps in comparison. How many investors have true to nature geographical diversification? If our mutual fund industry is say worth 25 lakh crores, as I've told you, 99.8% of the investors have invested in the Indian context only, Indian equities only, either directly or through the mutual fund route. Only 10,000 crores approximately would be the exposure, or even less than that would be the exposure to the international equities through the mutual fund route. How many investors would have invested directly is a different you know, data altogether, but that's a question mark. Investors don't lose as much money in market corrections as they lose in sideways consolidations. And this is where the true geographical diversification actually comes into play. And let me showcase to you one such incidence in terms of the sideway consolidation in the Indian markets, and at the same time what happened in the US context, and why making investment in the US context during this period would have made a lot of sense for the investors. It can work vice versa also, where US there could have been a consolidation phase in the US markets and the Indian markets would have done well. So that's the reason why a combination of two geographical diversifications, both domestic as well as the global one, will make a lot of sense. So far I've only spoken about the two asset classes, and here we are going to talk about triple advantage. So you can imagine there will be a third asset class which will be part and parcel of this discussion also. When Indian equities were in sideways consolidations, how many of you knew that from 1992, post Harshad Mehta scam, till 2002, Indian equities delivered negative returns over a 10-year period? But naturally, because you have to invest in equity as an asset class for long-term wealth creation, we continue to stick to this asset class. And you cannot ignore that asset class, because finally, when the breakout happens, it happened the way it's showing on your chart. It was just a one-way upward movement as far as the Indian equity markets were concerned. So please understand that this sideway consolidation was a period during which the US equity markets delivered stupendous returns. And let me explain to you how did that happen. There was a great opportunity in the US market from 1990 to 2000. During the same period when there was sideways consolidation in the Indian equity markets, it just went one way up. It was a tremendous opportunity which was there in the global context and in the US context. And currently today we are going to talk about only the US markets and not the global markets. The composite return from April 1992 to March 2002, let's assume that we had invested, we are now going to talk about a proper asset allocation of 85% in the Indian equities and 15% in the global US equities, not global equities. And that composite index of 85-15, if we would have done that composite index and invested accordingly from 1992 to 2002, when Indian equities delivered no returns, during that period, Nifty 50 delivered negative 1.21% return, S&P 500 delivered 11.11% CAGR during that entire period, and the composite index would have delivered 1.76% positive return. Alpha of almost 4% versus if you were only stuck in Indian equity during that course of time. So first and foremost, as I said, it should make sense. It should be complementary to add an asset class, which should add returns in your overall portfolio. And that's exactly what you're seeing currently. At the same time, it should be less volatile, because, you know, by increasing an asset class and creating a huge volatility really does not make sense to add that asset class. The same data I'm going to show you graphically, and that will make a lot of sense for the viewers also. If this was Nifty 50 during that 92 to 2002 period, a negative 1.21%, this orange graph is the S&P 500 and the green one is the composite index of 85-15. which is under consideration currently, and that is the topic of our discussion today. This is what we call geographical diversification in its true sense. Something similar from 2008 January to now, if Nifty had delivered 4.98%, S&P had delivered almost 7% return, and a composite index could have delivered 5.21%. Again, graphically, if you represent that, Nifty 50 delivered 5%, S&P 500 delivered almost 7%, and the composite index definitely delivered better returns than Nifty 50 during this period also. Now, what is the triple advantage, and what is that third component, and which is that third asset class is what we are going to talk and discuss. I'm sure by now you must have guessed what is that third asset class. No, that third asset class is not gold. That third asset class is the currency. As you can see here, this is the INR versus dollar. When the dollar appreciates and you have invested in international equity, it adds to your returns. And as you can see, from 2010 to 2020, INR has only depreciated against dollar. How much will it add on going forward? We cannot guesstimate that. But at the same time, the usual and the general perception is that INR generally would be a depreciating currency as far as dollar is concerned. And that's what should add to you and your portfolio in terms of the returns also, if you have that dollar diversification through US equity exposure. Now, triple advantage of domestic, global, plus the third contributor currency. If you see this data, calendar-wise, in 2010, if S&P 500 had delivered 15.10%, that time rupee had appreciated, so there was a negative outcome as far as dollar was concerned. So it delivered 11.2% overall. BSE 500 delivered 17.9%. Outperformance versus S&P BSE 500 and the dollar plus S&P 500 was negative 6.7. The next year, 2011, the outperformance of adding US equity or international equity with dollar diversification, 47.4%. So overall, if you see from 2010 to now, if your overall return was 193%, total return, I'm talking about year on year, if you just add them up, S&P 500 delivered 107.7 out of that. That means 85.4% was delivered through dollar diversification and the dollar appreciation. The same thing if you would have applied as an 85-15 composite index, this is what would be the outcome. Outperformance of almost 13% over the same period of 2010 to 2020 by adding that flavor of US equity, that 15%. The question you may want to ask me is that why only 15% and why not higher? Because in the Indian context, if you want to be in a large cap space, you need to have minimum 80% in large cap, Indian equities, domestic equity. And that's the reason that why that 15% is in US, because that large cap 80% can grow to 85% in terms of the valuations. That's why that cushion of 15 to 20%. So the current composite index, which we are talking about, the principal large cap fund, is 85% domestic Indian equities and 15% US large cap or mega cap stocks. This is a true geographical diversification. As I just mentioned, 15% in US large cap companies and 85% in large cap companies. US large cap companies, all of us have seen the markets in the US in the past decade or so. They are true global leaders, high and stable growth, dominant businesses, globally recognized brand names. These are all true to label mega cap brands, mega cap stocks, mega cap in terms of market cap, every which way. Portfolio diversification, adding performance and lowering volatility. Unless and until it adds performance, it does not make sense to add onto a existing portfolio. On top of that, it should reduce your volatility, and I'll showcase to you that it reduces volatility also by increasing that exposure or giving exposure to US large cap stocks. Universe consists of US large cap companies with a minimum market cap of 50 billion. In the Indian context, there are not more than 4 to 5 companies which qualify as a $50 billion market cap. Two of them we've just mentioned, three of them rather. Reliance, TCS, and HDFC Bank, and a couple of more names would be added to that, which would be in that $50 billion market cap scenario. The allocation to US large cap would be comprised 15 stocks and 4 to 6 sectors. And you know, Principal is a big organization in the US context, much bigger than what they have in terms of the outfit here in the Indian context. But it's one of the biggest you know, fund managers in the US, and they have that expertise to capture the right stocks, right sectors at the right valuations. And that's what is brought to the table by Principal US you know, parent in this particular product, which is the US large cap fund. We do not question country of origin, but do not invest in that country. You know, we are you know, using services and products of all these brands like Netflix, Amazon, Microsoft, HDFC Bank, Infosys, Facebook, and so on and so forth. But we are not owning those companies, unfortunately. So we do not mind you know, owning them as a product or a service, but unfortunately we are not able to use that the you know, brand value or the brand market cap in the Indian context in terms of investing in those stocks. And those are truly mega cap stocks, and that can actually enhance the overall returns and the portfolio journey and experience for the investors also. Adding sweetener can only enhance flavor. If you are adding sweetener, there is a reason why you are adding that sweetener. You don't want to make it bitter, you want to make it sweeter. So that's the reason, in, if you notice this data, in past 7 out of 10 years, including 2020, adding addition of S&P 500 only has enhanced returns under composite index of 8515. So that means if you were investing in, say, Nifty 100 stocks, but by adding that 15% in the US large cap stocks, in 7 out of 10 years, the composite index of 85 Indian companies and 15% US companies has only added to the overall returns. And on top of that, with lower volatility. And that was the prime importance and the prime consideration for considering why you should invest in US large cap companies. Let me show you quiz to you the performance backtest. Outperformance of 85-15 composite index. As you can see, the light blue is the composite index. The dark blue, the middle portion is the Nifty 100, and the Nifty 50 is that dark blue. So if you notice here, all the arrows which are pointing towards composite index have outperformed over 1 year, 3 year, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years period also. So by adding that US large cap companies, they have only added to the overall portfolio returns possibility as far as the investors are concerned. But adding sweetener reduces volatility also. And this, as you notice, the dark bar charts, the lines are the ones which is the composite index standard deviation or the volatility index. It is much lower than Nifty 100 or Nifty 50, and that's what our aim was, to add another asset class which adds on to the performance but reduces volatility. Now, what is the economic environment and support currently, and why is Principal Large Cap Fund NFO happening currently? So I'm sure many would be asking this question. You can post your questions in the chat box on this YouTube live. We will take up all those questions and queries post the session is over. So please write your questions as we are doing this session currently. The other positive macro factors are current account deficit is under control. What is current account deficit? The difference between countries' exports and imports. Generally, a country like India is a current account deficit because we are dependent on imports of crude oil, gold, metals, a lot of these electronic items, etc. But for the first time after many years, thanks to COVID and thanks to the trade trade imbalances which are getting rectified currently, we are in a current account surplus zone, and we our forex reserves have grown to almost $535 billion. Every 1 rupee depreciation will add on to the cushion as far as the Indian government is concerned or the RBI is concerned in terms of some fiscal stimulus going forward also. This is the cushion which RBI is building up as we speak. INR has remained more or less stable than other global currencies, but generally, we have seen, as I've shown you in that chart, the INR versus US, INR has always depreciated. How long and how far it will depreciate going forward is a question mark. But yes, it can add on to the first of all, stability of the overall portfolio, plus it can enhance your returns also. Oil is at between $40 to $45. This is extremely positive as far as the Indian markets are concerned, because as I said, we are dependent on crude. 70% of our imports are crude only, and every dollar drop in oil prices can save us 12,000 crores. And some estimates of these oil prices have been come off from $70 to $75 to currently about $40 or so. We are sitting on a huge cushion of almost 4-4.5 lakh crores only because of the crude oil import bill, which has come down substantially. China has resumed its supply chains, and something similar is happening across the globe right now. Hopefully, things will become normal sooner than later, post the COVID issue is sorted out. Other factors: huge liquidity of $10 to $11 trillion created by central governments across the globe. Now, where is that created? Those are created in countries which are 0% in interest rates or negative interest rates regimes. Now, because we have no other avenues to invest, this $10 trillion investment is only chasing equity to generate that extra return for the investors. Now, that is what is being seen in even the cash flows or liquidity coming into the emerging markets like India also. What happened in the month of March was the flight of liquidity. Now, what is happening currently is the inward liquidity coming back into the system and chasing both global equity as well as Indian equity. How long will this continue is a question mark. Maybe we are stretched in terms of valuations. All of us agree to that. But this volatility is what will help principal large cap fund to actually create a portfolio in the current scenario. And another thing which I liked about principal large cap fund, and which I'm going to discuss in the subsequent slides, and that's the reason why I've decided to talk about it. Generally, I don't talk about equity funds, but I like the facility which they are providing in the current context, and that's what is going to be the clincher as far as the investors are concerned, and very, very positive as far as investors are concerned. Stable commodity prices and good monsoon to keep prices under check. Currently, of course, food inflation is going a little haywire, but that should settle down. Interest rates will remain soft and benign because RBI will step in as and when required. They have made that very, very clear that they will step in as and when required. That means there is a possibility of further rate cuts also, and thereby aiding economic recovery. All these are positive macro factors as far as the Indian markets are concerned. Something similar would be seen in the global context also in the US markets. Why large caps and why not mid caps and small caps? All of us are aware that mid caps and small caps right now are in a vulnerable stage because of the COVID. A lot of companies may fold up also, especially in the small cap space. But the large cap top 100 companies account for 77% of market cap, and something similar like that on the sales and the profitability also. Profit contribution towards the profitability, the earnings. Lower volatility and stable returns, that's what's been seen both in the Indian context and in the US context also. Higher liquidity, they are extremely liquid stocks, so there is no problem in even in if the markets correct in future and sometime in the near future, should be no issue because there is ample liquidity in these large cap stocks, especially when you're investing in mega cap stocks of US or mega cap stocks in the Indian context also. And there is a broader research on these large cap stocks. So these are all the factors pointing towards why you should be actually concentrating in the large cap space rather than in the mid cap and the small cap at the current juncture. Higher returns with lower volatility. As you can see, the light blue bar charts are the large cap returns over the last 3 years, 5 years, and 15 years. Oh, sorry, 10 years, and they are much better than mid cap and the small cap, but with much lower volatility. So not only is the global context of the US companies adding to the returns and reducing volatility, but by being in the large cap and not being in the mid cap or the small cap, the potential of earning higher returns with lower volatility also enhances, and that's the reason why this 85/15 large cap fund is being launched currently. Stock selection is also a key. Widespread by dispersion with large cap companies. So if you see this data, this is a very interesting analysis. Top 25 of the Nifty 100 have delivered 15.6% CAGR over last 10 years period. As against that, 26th to 50th company has only delivered 5.4%. 51 to 75th company in that top 100 has delivered negative 4.6% over the last 10 years. This is a 10-year data. It's a long enough data. And the 76th to 100th company has delivered negative 18.80. So by just being in Nifty 100 is not really sufficient, but the right stock selection, which Principal Large Cap Fund, both the domestic fund management team and the US Large Cap Fund management team will do and add value to the entire portfolio, is what needs to be looked at also. All the 100 stocks equivalent, if we had done all the 100 stocks equal weight, then the return for the last 10 years would have been 5.3%, and Nifty 100 for the last 10 years is 9% returns. So as you can notice from this chart, only within that space, within that index of Nifty 100 also, it is extremely imperative that the fund managers select the right stocks and do not get stuck with the wrong stocks. Now, what is the what does this Teenpatti have to do with the mindset of investors and with Principal Large Cap Fund? The reason why I liked this product, because of this specific feature which does not create Abhimanyus out of equity investors. What this feature does is, it's like a mindset of a Teenpatti player. So when you go to play Teenpatti, you go with 10,000 rupees and you make say 5,000 rupees on top of that. That 5,000 you give it to your spouse and you want to play with that 10,000. You want to take that profit off the books and give it to your spouse and only play with your principal. Something similar is being thought out in the the add-on facility which they have created during this NFO stage itself, both on the investment side also and on the profit booking side also. So you will not get stuck. Your 100 rupee need not go entirely into large cap fund at the current high valuation probability. But you can spread that over the next 4 months, over four installments. And let me explain to you how does this work. So Smart Facility and My Gain Facility are the two ones. Smart Facility is how you will invest your money smartly. And My Gain is where you can decide on the target return which you want. And after achieving the target return, how that money should be brought back into your fold, like just like the example which I gave in Teenpatti, that 5,000 rupees of profit, when you've made it, you want to pocket that profit, and that pocketing of that profit can happen even in this particular product of Principal Large Cap Fund. Now, what is a smart facility? 25% of the money which you give, so the 100 rupee which you give, 25% will go towards the NFO launch investment, and 75% will be parked in Principal Cash Management Fund. Next month, if the markets correct by 3%, that balance 25%, additional 25% will be invested. If the markets have not corrected, by the end of the month, additional 25% will be invested. Something similar thereafter, in the second month, if the markets have corrected by 3%, and then thereafter 3%, 6%, additional 25% will be invested. If not, by the end of the month, that 25% will be invested, and same thing will happen in the fourth installment. So this is what we call smart investment in terms of the timing of the market, because the US elections are around the corner in the month of November. We expect huge volatility both in the Indian context and in the global context also, US especially, because it is an election year. And this will help the investors not to put all their eggs in one basket at one go in the current context. So you can adopt this smart facility, give that 100 rupee in the NFO, and that NFO will divide that into four installments over the next 4 months, which will cover the November month of US elections and thereafter. So if you are in September, October, November, December, and January, by that time, if there are any corrections or volatility which is creeping into the markets, both in the Indian context or the US context, you will be able to take advantage of that and create a portfolio in your favor. Now let me talk about how does the MyGain facility work. Let's assume that I have invested 1 lakh rupee in the large cap fund in the initial stage, and I want to have a target return of 20%. That means when 1 lakh grows to 1,20,000, that 20% appreciation, which is 20,000 rupees, will come back automatically into principal cash management fund or any other fund of your choice. You may want to choose any other debt fund from the basket of principal mutual fund, and you will bring that money back into your fold. Then thereafter, the markets, you're back to that 1 lakh original investment, and again, as and when the markets go into that 20% category return, that additional 20,000 will also come back, and so on and so forth. So this is that MyGain facility, where the funds will move from large cap fund after achieving your target back into the choice of your choice of fund, which can be a debt fund or any other, if you want to get into an equity saving kind of a product or a dynamic asset allocation fund or principal mutual fund, that's your choice altogether. So that's the way you will be able to pocket the profits, and you will not become Abhimanyus who is stuck in a chakravyuh, not knowing when to exit or do profit booking. So this is an extremely important facility which really attracted me to talk about this as a product also, because I like this combination of large cap in the Indian context and a mega cap in the US context. And I wanted to showcase to the audience as to how these large caps in the Indian context are actually not large cap in the global context. They may be treated like small caps except for a couple of stocks like Reliance, TCS, HDFC banks and so forth. So this is what we had to speak about in terms of how the product is designed, what are the facilities within that product itself in terms of investments and disinvestments, and how do we compare as a composite index versus a single asset class. So we have talked about triple advantage, which is the Indian equity, the US equity, and dollar diversification. That's the triple advantage we've spoken about so far. Now, how do you position this product? All of us are aware that the multi-cap guidelines have been issued by SEBI recently, where they have spoken about minimum 25% in large cap, minimum 25% in mid cap, and minimum 25% in small cap. After having discussions with various CEOs and CIOs, at least I have, this is my opinion, you may wish to differ or you may wish to ignore it. My opinion is that most of the fund managers do not wish to stick to this multi-cap story of 25, 25 and 25, especially in the small cap segment at the current juncture. So what people used to think, that there will be a big rally happening in the small cap and the mid cap because of shift of money going from in that multi-cap category from large cap towards small cap, I think they will be in for a rude shock. According to me, the reverse will happen, where most of the fund managers will convert these schemes into large cap or large and mid cap or a flexi cap, but they do not wish to add on to small caps. If that is the case, that means there will be a further fillip to the large and the large and mid cap kind of story rather than in the small cap story. So if at all, I would presume that going forward, there should be some correction on the small cap side. If this rebalancing happens over the next 6 months or so, it's not going to happen overnight, so you don't expect that movement happening suddenly. But if you have to reposition your portfolio at the current juncture, which is the red zone as far as I'm concerned, it's an expensive valuation zone, you may wish to come out of your existing portfolios of multi-cap and other large and mid-caps currently, and park that money in the NFO stage of principal large cap fund, of which only 25% will be invested to start with in the NFO level in the month of September. But subsequently, your money will be invested slowly and steadily over the next 3 months thereafter. So that means you will be able to take advantage of that volatility which will creep in because of the US elections and other factors and the the expensive valuations and so on and so forth. So this is what I would do as a positioning of this product. Make it your core portfolio. That's one side of the story. And the second side of the story would be in this rebalancing and this multi-cap debate, you may wish to relook at your portfolios, get out of those products and get into a large cap fund of principal mutual fund, and slowly and steadily create a portfolio with principal large cap fund through that smart facility. This is what I had to say as far as the product was concerned, the positioning was concerned, the triple advantage was concerned. I hope I have not disappointed you, because I had not discussed in my tweets and my invites also as to what I'm going to talk about, what is that triple advantage all about. So I'm sure you have got some great insights into global context, the Indian context, the third contributor, and so on and so forth. If you want to know more about this, you can log on to www.principalindia.com. They have created a special microsite for this large cap NFO. There is a calculator also which they have created. You can use that calculator to backtest for SIP, for lump sum, etc., how this composite index would have performed versus a single allocation to just a Nifty 100, a mutual fund for a very successful NFO launch. Thank you. Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.